Good morning, friends. Wishing you all a very happy National Technology Day. On behalf of the Nehru Science Center, National Council of Science Museum, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all for today's National Technology Day lecture. We're extremely honored to have with us Dr. Anil Kakodkar, sir, who will be delivering this National Technology Day lecture on the topic dealing with energy needs in the context of climate crisis. It's all the more important that we have with us Dr. Kakodkar, who will be delivering this lecture, primarily because the National Technology Day, you know, it came into being after the Pokhran test, which happened exactly on this day in 1998. The then Honorable Prime Minister, Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji, declared this as the National Technology Day. Incidentally, the Pokhran 1 happened in 1974 on 18th May, the Pokhran 2 in 11th May 1998. Subsequently, we had the nuclear peace agreement. In all of these three, there is one constant, and that constant is Dr. Anil Kakodkar, sir. Sir, we are extremely honored and privileged that you have accepted our invitation to deliver this lecture dealing with energy needs in the context of climate crisis. Sir, I request you to please deliver your lecture, sir.
Thank you, Shri Kenneth. It's really an honor for me to be talking about this particular very important topic on a National Technology Day, and that too National Technology Day being celebrated by Nehru Science Center. National Technology Day, we celebrate to commemorate the nuclear tests that took place 22 years ago. That brought us energy security. I'm sorry, that brought us the national security. Of course, we went through, as Shri Kenneth alluded to, we went through an international agreement with several countries for nuclear energy, you know, to opening up of nuclear commerce for peaceful purposes. And the idea was to enhance our energy security with the help of nuclear energy. And now we are all concerned with the climate change. And so we are caught between energy security on one side and climate security on the other. And I think these two together are a big challenge, particularly for a country like India, where our development aspirations are yet to be realized. And so it is with this background that I have chosen this topic for today's National Technology Day lecture. I have a number of slides to sort of refer to as I proceed with the lecture. And so let us go to the first slide. We leave the title slide and let us go to the first slide. Can we get the first slide?
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. So, the first slide essentially is a correlation between shall I go ahead? Yeah, so the first slide is a correlation between Human Development Index and per capita annual energy consumption. As many of you would be aware, the two are very closely linked, and the for improving the quality of life, there are several important ingredients that must be brought in, but energy is also a very important ingredient. And if you can, is the slide visible to people? Hello? Visible to? Yeah, second slide, okay. So so as I was mentioning, this correlation, you know, each dot there represents a country, and these dots have been colored. Now, if you look at the blue triangles at the top, which are essentially along a horizontal line near the top, they are the countries which are enjoying very high quality of life. And of course, their human development index is around 0.95. And with that level of human development, whether one consumes little more energy or little less energy, it doesn't matter, because they're already at a very high level of energy consumption. In fact, most of the world energy resources have been cornered by these countries by now. On the other hand, there are these on closer to the y-axis at the bottom, the green diamonds. These are the countries which have a very low quality of life, and so their human development index is low. But you could notice that even a slightest energy availability makes a big difference to the human development index. It's almost a vertical line close to the y-axis. And then in between these two, there are these red squares, which are the countries with average quality of life. And they essentially are the transition countries, where economy is growing, quality of life is improving. And which would mean that we need to enhance our energy access, availability, utilization, whatever you may like to call it, to something like factor of 5 from what it is today. And to be is a large country and would demand a very large share of global energy consumption. For example, if you look at like for like, then we are something like 1/6 of the world population. So we should be using something like 16% of the global energy consumptions at given point of time. Now, this is the challenge. And then now we have to see how can we meet this challenge in terms of enhancing our quality of life while remaining conscious and while addressing the climate crisis that is also there along with us. To go a bit deeper into this problem, I think it will be more convenient to look at energy in the context of electricity, because electricity is one of the largest energy user is electricity production. Electricity production, of course, we need that as light and home appliances and all. But industry requires electricity in a big way. And now transportation also has started requiring electricity in a big way. The commercial world requires electricity in a big way. So electricity production occupies the largest share of energy consumption. And then, of course, there are oil, gas, and other energy forms which will come in. But since electricity is the largest, I want to develop this argument more in the context of electricity, and I'll come back to this issue of total energy. And so if we can go to the next slide, slide number 3, which actually looks very similar to the figure I showed earlier. Only thing is, the x-axis, instead of energy consumption per capita, this is now electricity consumption per capita. But rest of the picture is more or less similar. And so this, there is something universal about the shape of the correlation. In fact, even if you plot a correlation for different states in India, you would find a similar correlation. So only thing is, what was blue in the previous figure are green in this figure. And so in the subsequent description, I'm going to use these countries by describing them, the countries with high quality life as green dot countries, countries with medium quality of life as pink dot countries, and countries with low quality of life as purple dot countries. And you just remember that as we go forward. Shall we go to the next slide, slide number 4? And the slide number 4 is, it essentially tells now what is the climate change concern. And as many of you would be aware, we have this international framework convention on climate change. And there is meetings taking place of countries and at fairly, I think year after year, these meetings are taking place. And their work is supported by a group of specialists, international panel, intergovernmental panel on climate change. And they keep on issuing a lot of reports based on scientific studies and research. Now, there one of the latest reports titled IPCC Special Report on Global Warming of 1.5 degrees. It says staying below 1.5 degrees in 2100 will require cuts in greenhouse gas emissions of 45% below 2010 levels by 2030, which is only 10 years away. And it further says to reach net zero greenhouse gas emission by the year 2050, which is 30 years away. So we have only 10 years to realize deep emission cuts and around 30 years to reach zero emissions while addressing development aspirations of much of the world. And thus, the actions have to start now, leveraging available rapidly deployable technologies that can achieve this goal. We obviously cannot meet this challenge by research which is happening today, which may take rapidly some time to get converted into technology and then some further time to sort of deploy this to adequate level to make an impact. We need ready-made solutions for this purpose. Now, a lot is happening. For example, renewable energy is an important deployment option. And across the world, in India also, we have made a lot of progress in deployment of solar energy, deployment of wind energy. But while that is true, nuclear power can make vital contribution to meeting zero emission target while delivering the increasingly large quantities of baseload electricity needed for global economic development. And that baseload electricity is important because both solar and wind are variable energy sources. And so they can't deliver baseload, which is very important for the stability of the grid. Now, these have been studied both, for example, there is a report brought out by MIT in 2018 titled "The Future of Nuclear Energy in a Carbon Constrained World." And there is also in 2018 an IAEA report called "Climate Change and Nuclear Power." And they recognize this challenge, and their conclusion is that without nuclear contribution, the cost of achieving deep decarbonization targets would increase significantly, which is non-fossil baseload energy, and which is the only non-fossil baseload energy. And renewable energy, primarily consisting of solar, wind, also to some extent hydro and biomass. And it is this optimum combination which will allow us to meet this dual challenge of the deep decarbonization and also meeting the development aspirations. Now, in this broad framework, let us see what should be the actions to achieve these objectives. So let's go on to the next slide, slide number 5, which begins with actions. Now, I think the action should be the countries with high quality of life, which I define as green dot countries in the second figure, which I mentioned. For these countries, their human development index is already very high. So I think they must reduce their electricity consumption. Many countries have actually done so. And by doing so, there is no impact on their human development index, as I mentioned earlier. And of course, they will need some replacement capacity, because although they don't have to add net electricity generation, but some replacement of old assets may be necessary. And there they could be doing it with kind of cleaner energy resources, both renewable energy as well as nuclear. And achieve decarbonization of electricity generation. If we now move to the countries with average quality of life, which in the second figure one can call pink dot countries. Now, these are the countries where the demand is very high, economy is growing, and there'll be a positive impact on human development index. Now, it is these countries where should be the biggest target for new electricity addition. And this actually must be achieved through non-fossil electricity generation means, and also decarbonize the current electricity generation assets. And this actually, there is a business case, because these are the countries who can afford to pay their economy would create demand for these kind of electricity requirements. And I think that should be the very big focus. And India certainly belongs to this category. The third countries are, of course, countries at the bottom of the pyramid, where the quality of life is low. And there, of course, we need energy access for survival in most cases. And I think there must be subsidy to provide energy. If we can supply clean energy, so much the better. But they must get subsidized energy sources. If and they may not have capacity to pay, and so international action is called for here. Now, having recognized the actions to be taken by different categories of countries, and of course, we all know the Paris process, where different countries have kind of pledged their contribution. Of course, they are voluntary. And of course, if you carry out a sum total of all this contribution and assume that all of them would actually fructify, even then the assessment is that you will never be nowhere close to the 1.5 degree target. You will be in fact much more than 2 or closer to 3 degrees temperature rise. So we have many more solutions to put in place. But while that is so, in reality, for example, if you go to the next picture number, slide number 6, change in global energy-related CO2 emission and avoided emissions in 2017-18, it looks that while countries are making effort, but as the economy is growing, of course, along with that, the energy use is growing. Along with energy use, the carbon emission is growing. And countries have taken measures. For example, energy efficiency, they have taken measures to sort of deploy renewables in a larger way. And there are several other measures, including nuclear. But all put together still amount to a net addition. And so in 2018, we ended up emitting more carbon dioxide than was the case in 2017. So a lot of actions are being taken, but clearly they are not adequate. Can we go to the next slide, meeting climate targets? Now, obviously, different countries have to find out their own ways. In India, we have to find our own way. But these ways should be consistent with meeting that 1.5 degrees target. Germany, in fact, is often quoted as a country which took very aggressive steps. In fact, they pledged at Paris that their 2020 climate goals would be to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 40%, reduce primary energy consumption by 20%, and increase the share of renewables in energy consumption to 20%. And the government there is taking aggressive steps to achieve that. Their total electricity production is around 650 billion units, and out of which 50% they target to be renewable. And there's a major program going on. The nation did more than any other to unleash the modern renewable energy industry to be renewable. But it is likely to fall short of its goals for reducing harmful carbon dioxide emission. And that is even after spending over 500 billion euros, which translated to rupees, amounts to rupees 40 lakh crores. And by 2025, to overhaul their energy systems. Now imagine a electricity system which is producing 650 billion units. Their budget is 40 lakh crores to achieve those targets which they have set. In India, we are currently producing 1600 billion units, which is close to 2.5 to 3 times the German electricity production. We have a large unmet energy requirement and that would mean going another 4 to 5 times higher, and which means that we have to cater to a program which is 10 times larger than what Germany's program is. So you can imagine, if you want to follow that approach, what kind of resources would be required. And clearly that is impossible. I think in this context, we should also look at the example of Japan. Japan is a country which before Fukushima has been producing roughly 30% of its electricity from nuclear. Of course, after Fukushima, they shut down all their nuclear plants to carry out detailed safety assessments, and they have started putting some of them back in service. They also carried out a review of their energy systems in times to come, both in the context of situation within the country, but also the larger climate change concerns that is bothering us globally. Also remember that the global sensitivity about nuclear arises because of the nuclear bombing at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, which also happened to be in Japan. So Japan is the country which has seen the brunt of the negatives of nuclear energy. Japan is the country which has seen the brunt of a major nuclear accident which has made a global impact. But they carried out a review, and in 2018, Japanese government revised its energy plan to update the 2030 target for nuclear energy to 20 to 22% of the total power generation. And this they will do by restarting their reactors. In addition, of course, their energy mix will have 27% LNG, 25% coal, 23% renewable, and 3% oil. Now recognize there is a big difference between Germany and Japan. Germany is a part of European Union or the European grid, and they can exchange electricity at will. Depending on the need, they can import electricity or export electricity. They are also connected with a gas pipeline, and so there is that another energy supply available to them. And besides, of course, there is a fairly large coal that they have on their soil. Of course, we are all going away from these fossil energy sources. Contrast that with Japan. Japan is an island country. It has to depend on solar, wind, which they might be able to harness on their own landmass. So they have to work the country, I would imagine, because their energy requirements are in units, which is a little less than twice what Germany produces. And they have to worry about the situation about the security of supply. There's an issue about storage. You can't store a lot of conventional energy. And all these factors have obviously been factored in making their own plans. And so the point is, I put these two contrasts just to drive home the point that I think blind following of any country is going to be very harmful for us. We need to follow based on our own needs. And that is what I'm going to talk next about. Can we go to the next slide? So in that context, what should be the strategy for it? Yes, slide number 8, you are right. So what should be the strategy for India's electricity generation plan? Now, as I mentioned earlier, we should be reaching something like a threshold of 2,400 kilogram oil equivalent per capita. Now, the same threshold in the context of electricity as of the current scene would translate to around 500 kilowatt hour per capita. And that would amount that we should be able to generate totally around 8,000 billion units as against 1,600 billion units that we are generating currently. Now, in the ultimate analysis, when you want to decarbonize India's energy or electricity generation, renewable to be produced, so 50% of 8,000 billion units will be 4,800 being hydro here, fossil energy, and also maintain a reasonable proportion between the variable generating capacity and base load generating capacity because of the cost implications, as we saw earlier. So it seems to me that we need to sort of create a 30-fold increase in the renewable energy, a 30-fold increase in nuclear energy, because that's the only base load non-fossil energy generating type. And we need near doubling of thermal, including the replacements, because, you know, this 230 gigawatts, some of it will have to be taken off the grid because of their age. But cumulatively, we need additional coal plants because at the moment, there doesn't seem to be a way of doing so. Now, this would make our electricity system roughly 70% electricity will become carbon free. And rest will, there is also still an issue of CO2 emission. And that will have to manage through recycle and reutilization of carbon dioxide itself. And if you do that, then we can make the total electricity generation in a kind of a decarbonized way. And we can imagine this is a major challenge. And let's see how we can attend to this challenge. Can we go to the next slide, slide number 9? Now, this is talking about nuclear. The program of nuclear energy generation in the country, as I see it now, we have something like 6,780 megawatts operating capacity, so 6.7 gigawatts operating. There are units under construction amounting to 6.7 gigawatts, and there are approved projects which will, financially approved. So they will also get completed over a period of time. That amounts to 9 gigawatts. And there are others in planning that amount to something like nuclear capacity. So we have miles to go. And of course, as I said, I'm not going to venture when that will happen. Let's go to the next slide. Now, let's remember, as I mentioned earlier in the beginning, electricity is not the only thing, although electricity is the more important energy. See, we have primary energy sources available in various forms, and they are listed in this figure on the left-hand side column. And I included gas hydrates there in red color, because gas hydrates, we have huge potential, but it is yet untapped. We have to develop capability to be able to tap. But if you are able to do that, we'll get much cleaner fuel compared to coal, and in much larger quantity. And we can get rid of our import, which is a huge bill as of now. But the short point is, we have these energy sources in different forms. And then we convert them in the form of suitable carriers and carry this energy to the consumers. And the consumers could be in agriculture, consumers could be in industry, commercial world, residential world. They could be in transportation. There are non-energy uses, for example, materials and all, and there are other uses. Now you carry this energy to these users in the form of electricity, as I mentioned, which is the largest. You carry in the form of oil. For example, our entire transport fleet is on oil, and good part of industrial world runs on oil. We transport this energy in the form of gas. Again, a lot of industries run on gas. Transportation also is running on gas to some extent. And of course, we transport it in the form of solids, coal to nuclear power stations, or the briquettes of biomass for other heating and electricity generation operations and so on. it looks to me that as the development would proceed, the use of electricity will keep on increasing. And particularly because end-use appliances are very convenient. And things like, for example, if electricity mobility increases in a big way, then a good part of oil, which currently energizes transport, which is mostly imported, will be able to substitute by electricity derived from whatever means we have in the country, which eventually will become non-fossil. So oil, electricity share should go up. Oil as a carrier, we should bring it down, because you know, that's where we are paying maximum import bill. Gas we should improve, because you know there is larger kind of outlook, better outlook for gas going forward than oil. And also it's more cleaner fuel than oil. Solid also we should sort of attempt to decrease. Certainly coal, but other forms of solid also we should do. Now to be able to do that, we need a lot of technology thrust, particularly if you want to decarbonize energy use consistent with what I mentioned just now. For example, we have to put greater thrust on electric mobility, which is happening. I think also important is the hydrogen electric mobility, because you know if you produce non-fossil hydrogen and then run electric vehicles, which are driven by fuel cells powered by hydrogen, then you have you overcome the range limitation, and particularly for heavy vehicles or for that matter buses going long distances, I think this is a very important option that we should pursue. We should also look at the surplus agriculture residue after taking care of the other demands on agriculture residue, particularly as animal feed and all, to convert that into fluid fuel, because that's a clean energy and it has a large potential. It can actually, it's equivalent to the entire gasoline use in our country, and that's what we should give big thrust. Government is pushing the 2G technology, 2G ethanol technology in this context. We should also emphasize coal to fluid because that is what will enable us to minimize energy import bill. We should develop technologies to convert solar, nuclear and biomass energy, whether in the form of electricity or in the form of heat, into hydrogen. We should develop, as I said earlier, technologies for carbon capture and utilization so that whatever, you know, because we'll have to continue to use carbon, but we are able to make sure that that carbon dioxide doesn't get emitted into the environment. And for example, a lot of carbon dioxide can be pumped into oil wells for enhanced oil recovery. I'm just giving you one example. There is a lot of potential in terms of the non-fossil heating and refrigeration, and there we can make a lot of difference. And then of course I must make, you know, many of our colleagues in petrochemicals or refinery sector, they get worried whether for them because of the climate issue, whether you know, what is the outlook for them. And I think outlook for them is great, because petrochemical is another area where the import in the country is much larger than our export, and so we need to emphasize on petrochemical and also have flexible plants so that whenever there is a need, we can produce the required quantity of petroleum fuels. Can we go to the next slide? And this is really my last slide. I have talked about different energy, but this is based on, of course, several studies, and we are living in an interconnected world where we keep discussing. But I would like to draw your attention to three prime documents. One is the Technology Vision 2035, which was brought out by Department of Science and Technology, the TIFAC, the Technology Information Forecasting Assessment Council. And that talks about various aspects of technology, including energy technology. And there it says by 2035, we should take power generation in the country to 1,000 gigawatt electric at the national level. And 50% of that should be from renewable energy sources. There is another report, which also I happened to chair. This time, this report is by Vivekananda International Foundation. This is specifically on nuclear power. And that report broadly says we should have 63 gigawatts by the year 2035. That was the target of Department of Atomic Energy, and that should still remain the target. India should aim to become global nuclear manufacturing hub, because this has to go hand in hand with our domestic program to make our nuclear activities more competitive and also earn, improve our situation in the context of balance of payment. We must create an export footprint to export nuclear reactors outside. And of course, to doing so, finance is going to be a challenge, but we should recognize engineering to find the money that is necessary. The third report, which I want to draw your attention to, is the report which we did, which also I happened to chair, for the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. And that looked at the petroleum and natural gas situation in the country. And there, in today's context, the broad conclusions are emphasized on 2G biofuel, because it can replace gasoline, as I mentioned. Emphasize on coal to gas or liquid. In fact, says that country should shift to gas economy, which also is actually happening. We must develop technologies for carbon capture and utilization, leveraging non-fossil hydrogen, because, in terms of making use of carbon dioxide, non-fossil hydrogen can play an important role. We should aim at becoming a net exporter in the context of petroleum or petrochemicals, as I mentioned earlier, and we should pursue gas hydrates aggressively. So for further reading, I recommend all of you to, these reports are available on the internet. You can download and make a detailed reading. But to conclude, I would only say that we have a major challenge, and that challenge, according to me, is solvable. We need to put our act together, and many of the things are already in place. But in terms of science and technology domain, in terms of research domain, we need to accelerate our delivery, because, as I said in the beginning, we don't have too much of time. We must produce results commensurate with the global effort and the global challenge. And if you want to do that, as a country with large energy consumption, we must play our role very responsibly. And I'm sure on a technology day, we should all dedicate ourselves to this cause. I would like to thank all of you for a patient listening. Thank you. Yeah. Vaishali Deshpande, thank you for this question. This is indeed a very important question, and I didn't touch upon that. And now I get an opportunity to respond to you. See, the point is, nuclear power plant, particularly the policies that we have adopted in India, we pursue what is called the nuclear recycle technology. In the sense, we utilize nuclear fuel thorium, uranium, plutonium, whatever, for generation of energy. And after the fuel comes out of a nuclear reactor, we treat that spent fuel as a resource. And we have all commercial industrial technologies for recycling the spent fuel. So we can recycle. We in fact do recycle both uranium and plutonium. And for example, entire fast breeder reactor is based on plutonium recovered from the first stage nuclear power plant. So recycle of uranium and plutonium, in fact, recycles something like upwards of 95 or in some cases even 98% of the spent fuel. Remaining 2% consists of either actinides, higher actinides, or the long-lived fission products. Now, out of these, we also developed industrial-scale technologies for separation of actinides. And we also developed technologies for separation of the long-lived fission products. For example, we can separate cesium. We can separate strontium. And of course, we are separating cesium and making use of that in irradiators. The actinides we can separate and put them back into fast reactors, for example, and convert them into products of lower half-life. So the short point I'm making is that the way we are pursuing Indian program, more than 99% of the waste, so-called waste, which everybody is concerned about, we will be recycling. It's only the small quantity that would remain, and we have the technology for converting that into glass, vitrification of this remaining waste. And I must tell you that this whole quantity is so small that in a reasonable size hall, I can store the entire waste that would arise for the entire program over a period of a decade or two. So the waste management program in India is well under control, is not an issue. Waste program is a major issue in countries where they do not want to recycle. And when they don't want to recycle, then you have to dispose of spent fuel as waste. And for which the world hasn't found the solution, and that has remained an unresolved issue. And I hope sooner or later the world will come back to the principles that we adopt here in India. There are other countries, France follows the same thing, Russia follows the same thing. But as far as India is concerned, this is not an issue. Well, thank you so much. Haan, dekh raha hu main, magar I'm only seeing myself. Well, thank you very much for very patient listening. And I hope in this lockdown mode where we had to resort to this mode, but I think this is the mode which is becoming prevalent, and I'm sure it will remain in vogue even after the lockdown is lifted, because we can reach large number of people, and that's an important technology for our country. So thank you very much once again, and good luck to you. Stay home, stay safe. Thank you.